ladies and gentlemen, back again for another Out and About. Francis?
Yes.
Roy? Jer? Back here, make the left, you'll see Jer. Today we're going to be diving into some more darker secrets of the city of Philadelphia.
A lot of macabre going on with these videos.
Yep. We are going to be introducing the YouTube community to, you may or may not know, a Mr. Gary Heidnik. Now, Gary Heidnik is probably one of the most known stories to come out of the late 80s, maybe 80s, in Philadelphia.
It was a big story.
Criminal history. Right next to the MOVE bombing, this is probably right there. In a different sort of way. But Gary Heidnik was
a nice guy.
He was not a nice guy at all.
Okay.
This gentleman, he's not even a gentleman, he's a fucking animal. But he came one short of being what, Frank?
A serial killer.
Mm-hmm. But he was a serial rapist, raping 8 women through the course of, I don't know, probably like 10 years. His first rape wasn't as documented as the last 6, but this is a pretty sick individual we're about to show to you.
Yes.
Gary Heidnik was born in Cleveland, Ohio. His parents divorced 4 months after he was born. 4 years after he was born. Lived 4 months with his mom. Then lived with his dad. And this is where the wheel started turning of, there's always that fucked up part in either a serial killer or serial rapist where their childhood really starts going to shit.
Yeah.
And for this, it was more mental abuse. His father, every time he pissed the bed.
A lot of it is.
Yeah.
With these guys, you know.
Mm-hmm. He had a problem peeing the bed. His father would make him take the piss-soaked sheet out and announce to the neighbors that he pissed the bed. It caused him to have, like, you know, social, like, awkwardness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it just fucked him up. Mm-hmm. After that, he was shipped off to military school in Virginia, where he dropped out. Joined the Army. From the Army, he wanted to be an Army medic. Dropped out of that. Was then shipped to San Antonio to finish out his Army. His Army, what's it called, Frank?
Training?
No, not Army training. Like, if you sign up for, like, a...
Yeah, you sign up for two years.
Yeah, tour, I guess you would say.
He was honorably discharged.
Honorably discharged for GI problems. So, basically, he was discharged for the shits.
Yes.
Comes to Philadelphia.
And headaches.
Not yet.
Oh, he didn't get the headaches
Comes
yet.
To Philadelphia. Soon. This is where he develops the headaches, the visions, the voices.
Yes.
Everything coming into motion. He gets diagnosed with schizophrenia and personality disorder. Now, back then, schizophrenia, it feels like now you can go into the hospital and you can just be diagnosed schizophrenia. Here's the meds, get out of my face. Back then, you really had to be a fucking kind of a little bit of a psycho to for them to say you had schizophrenia.
Mm-hmm.
And, so then after that, you know, meets a girl, but unbeknownst to her, he takes her sister out of a mental institution and rapes and tortures her inside of his house. She contracts gonorrhea. The sister finds out. He gets sentenced 15 years in prison, but it gets bumped down to 3 years because they said he wasn't mentally capable of making decisions, and he spent 2 to 3 years in a mental institution. Speaking of mental institutions, from the time he got out of the Army till he was arrested, 13 suicide attempts and 4 mental hospitals. One, the most he was at was at 44th and Market, which is no longer there.
You know, how many red flags do you need?
It's unbelievable. And even, you know, I know we're jumping back a little bit, but worth mentioning. So he, after he was discharged from the Army for having mental disorders, he applied for nursing school, which he got accepted. And he dropped out, didn't become a nurse, but was hired at the VA hospital in Coatesville as a nurse without a nursing license.
You know, when was this again? What era? Era?
Late 60s.
Yeah.
1966.
And that was a different time back then. You
know? So, and this is the same, you know, the Army discharged him. But they still hired him without a nursing degree to... it's fucked up. So, after all this course of time, after the rape, he said, you know what, I'm going to start my own religion. at my own church. And people came.
Yeah.
Yeah. People came. I mean, it was like...
He had followers
according
in his
to
church.
Witness reports, Thursdays and Sundays was his, like, days of... his days of worship. And the whole street, all Marshall Street, was blocked off because everybody was going in there to see Brother Gary. And also worth noting, Frank, his IQ, do you remember the number?
His IQ was 150. Was it 150?
148.
148, close.
Out of 175.
175 on the scale. Is genius level, but he was close to it. He was a very smart individual.
So it also shows you how he got, he made a religion, made all this stuff, and conned these girls to come with him.
A very manipulative. Yep.
Another manipulating guy. Wow, we nailed it this time.
Yes, we did.
Another manipulating individual that we're going to be diving into. Mm-hmm. Now, we're going to start the vlog off. It's going to be a lot more on the go. A lot less editing. It's not going to be as long as the H.H. Holmes video. But we're going to start, in the order we're going to do it, we're going to start with the victims. The six girls that he led into his house.
Mm-hmm.
Imprisoned, and we're going to describe the tortures they found in the House of Horrors. That is nicknamed for good old there, the House of 3500, roughly North Marshall Street in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So yeah, we're going to get into the first location. Frank, do you have anything to say before we dive in here?
Nope, I'm just very excited to get this, going, see the locations we got here.
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Just yesterday morning, they let me know you were gone. Suzanne, the plans they made put an end to you. I walked out this morning and I wrote down this song. I just can't remember who to send it to.
So here we are, 3rd and Girard. This is the first location of the first girl that Gary Heidnik picked up. November 25th, 1986, a Miss Josefina Rivera. She was 25 at the time. She actually used to dance at a nightclub, strip club down there. It was called Hearts and Flowers, and that's on Front and Girard. We'll be seeing that later, but she was a prostitute as well. Gary Heidnik pulled over here to the corner, asked her obviously if she wanted to get in for a $20 trick, as they called it back then. She got in the car. They went to his house. The request was to go in his basement and have sex. They started fooling around. Gary Heidnik then got on top of her and choked her until she became unconscious. He then chained her up. She remained there, but she became one of his most trusted prisoners. He would take her on like dates to several places. He would trust her with a lot of stuff. She actually even partook in disposing one of the prisoners that he murdered. So this is it, 3rd and Girard. This is victim one. Here we are. Victim number two. This is probably out of all of them, in my opinion, the saddest of the victims. Miss Sandra Lindsay. She was abducted December 3rd, 1986. She was 24 years of age. She was mentally disabled. She was, everybody knew her in the neighborhood. Everybody took care of her. Everybody looked after her. She took a stroll to get Christmas cards. Takes a stroll to get Christmas cards. She was in the wrong place at the wrong time, because Mr. Heidnik was here,
And I guess he worked this swindle his charm, took advantage of a very nice, you know, nice person, and got her in the car, choked her out. And this is a, as you'll see through, this is a, like a, what's it called, Frank?
What are you looking for here?
A trend. Wow, a trend. A trend. This is how he, you know, this is how he, he's very much a fan of the choking. And most of the reports say, as they describe being choked, that he's staring into their eyes, silent, like just, and visually just taking it all in of them passing out. So, he abducts her, and we're going to insert a picture over Frank's face to make him look prettier.
I don't think that's possible.
So, she's in the house. She's very, very scared. She's not redirectable because, like we said, she is mentally disabled. So, she is a handful for Mr. Heidnik. And I think too much of a handful. He, to punish her, he actually hangs her from a basement beam. Very similar to a crucifix. Arms extended to the full span. Supporting her chest cavity by her arms. And this causes the fluid to build around the heart. And I guess you eventually drown.
Well, suffocated. But yeah, I guess same. Yeah.
So she passes. But Heidnik knows, I guess, that, you know, if he hides her in the neighborhood or, you know, anywhere around, this might put up a white flag.
Red flag. Flags are red. White means surrender.
Gaia.
He's not surrendering. Not yet.
Yeah. That's what usually your mom waves before I penetrate.
What?
When she surrenders to me. So anyways, besides getting back to the story here, she's killed. So Gary Heidnik says, you know what? Let's just chop her up and just hide her in the fridge. That's what he does. He
chop you up, you in a fridge.
Through, you know, nighttime, there's complaints in the neighborhood of heavy machinery and construction going on out of his house. So I'm assuming that's what it was. There was also complaints of foul odors. He decided to boil Sandra's head for months.
And that's where the neighbors started complaining of the smell.
Mm-hmm.
It had to be awful. And somebody else came up and witnessed, one of the other captives came up and witnessed the head. And just imagine, what do you do?
I guess you just...
You look around and you see a head boiling in a pot. It's unimaginable.
I know the scene of Fatal Attraction when they're boiling the rabbit, I feel like a piece of shit. I couldn't imagine a human head. So, so she's killed. This is one of two of Heidnik's known murders.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, probably the saddest of the six. I mean, it's terrible, but this one is a little more depressing. So that's victim two. We're gonna head over to victim three in the continuing the twisted tour of Mr. Gary Heidnik.
I'm gonna run into the Rite Aid actually here. Do you want anything to drink? Tampons?
I'm good.
I'll get you tampons. So, here we are, 6th and Lycoming, where Heidnik picked up the third victim. Connor?
Mm-hmm. We have Miss Lisa Thomas, one of the youngest of the girls. She was picked up.
Do we have her age?
19 years old.
19 years old.
She was picked up December 23rd, 1986. Gary Heidnik was driving along. He's seen her at the corner coming out of the convenience store. Approached her, I guess got into talking. Convinced her to give her a ride to her house, which I don't know where she lived. She got in the car. Then he convinced her that, is it okay if I buy you lunch? Took her to get lunch. After that, I guess they got into talking.
She wound up at Gary Heidnik's house on Marshall Street, where he drugged her with a glass of wine. The next thing she remembers is being awoken in a pit with a piece of plywood over top of her.
Mm-hmm.
It came to...
it was a very shallow pit, too.
It came to fruition through witness reports and obviously when she was uncovered that she was in a pit, plywood, sandbags on top, and she only came out to get fed and when she was raped.
Mm-hmm.
Or, I mean, when she wasn't being raped, she was brought out to watch him rape another girl. Mr. Heidnik was a fan of the audience, and as psychological and like psycho as he was, he actually cared what people thought about him for some reason. So if they were watching him rape another girl and she disapproved or didn't show interest, she would be punished just as well.
Yeah, he'd get pretty pissed off about it.
So this is the third captive, and we're going to continue on the sick pickup tour of a Mr. Gary Heidnik.
Yes.
You have anything you want to say about this, Frank?
No.
Here we are. Victim four. A Miss Deborah Dudley. Abducted January 2nd, 1987. Miss Dudley was a part... Well, her family was part of the Heidnik ministry.
Part of the church.
One day she was going by, Gary Heidnik was in the garage, and he had a selection of VHS movies. That struck her interest. You know, she's looking at the movies, all of a sudden,
and
he tries kidnapping her, but she puts up the most fight out of most of them. Most of the victims. Actually, all of the victims. Physical altercation, struggling with Heidnik.
This is the entire time she was there.
Yeah. So she was constantly punished, but she spoke up for the rights of the girls. She was got them able to get decent meals sometimes, toileted, showered.
Mm-hmm.
But in this, you know, he really, you know, despised her. So, anyways, after all this, he decides, you know what? She needs to be taught a lesson. Let's put her in a pool of water and electrocute her. Unfortunately, she did not make it. So then he had to think of, what am I going to do? So he chopped her up, put her in a box. She sat for a little bit. And then from the help of Josephine Rivera, they took her here to the Wharton State Park, part of the Pine Barrens in New Jersey, right outside of Camden.
Mm-hmm.
And they dumped her body here. And yeah, and that was the end of her.
Yep. Now it's a little dark. We did a drone foot that you'll see in a moment.
Mm-hmm. Also, we're gonna put the picture of what she looked like in the box. We have that. Great.
Yep. Wait, the box?
The picture.
The box.
The picture.
It's that way. But yeah, it's a shame, and
yeah, she's the second and only killing that was proved for Mr. Heidnik. So that's it. We'll show you the overhead view.
Yeah.
Fifth victim of Mr. Heidnik, a Miss Jacqueline Askins, who was a friend of Miss Josephina Rivera. So Miss Josephina Rivera and Mr. Heidnik were out to a fancy dinner at McDonald's, and
about to leave my shit on this fucking traffic.
All right, so back after the pit stop, and So they're at the dinner, and
Josefina Riviera says,
"I work at this club here, coming up on your left-hand side. It is now called Signature Club. But before that, it was called Hearts and Flowers Club." Right there. So Miss Riviera said she could recruit somebody to join the basement. Now, this is where it gets tricky. If you're trying to escape a house, why would you recruit one of your friends to go into fucking hell? The worst of the worst. I don't know. I don't understand it. Maybe she was trying to gain his trust. I don't know. I wasn't there. I can't really judge. But,
Jacqueline Atkins was picked up.
Right here, approaching. Second and Gerard. And she was offered $500 to have sex with Mr. Heidnik. Let's see here. Let's get over here. Right here to this corner. So she was picked up here, and she was offered $500 to have sex with Mr. Heidnik, and like many of his victims, he choked her, and she passed out during sex. And the next thing she woke up, she was chained in the basement. So she is the fifth victim, and she was to replace the death of Mrs. Deborah Dudley.
I'll tell you what, though. Friends, do not let friends get abducted by whatever the fuck Heidnik was.
Serial rapist. I'd let you get abducted.
Would you?
$500
Let me get abducted?
At 86, that was like 10 grand. Okay, coming down Gerard Ave here. This is the last of the Heidnik girls that was captive. She was actually rescued within 24 hours of being abducted. Her name was Miss Agnes Adams. Insert picture right here on the corner where the church is. She was picked up right there. Fifth and Gerard. 24 years of age. Same way, picked up most of his girls, just, you know, asked them for a ride. And eventually, I guess, took him to the house and choked her out either beforehand or at the house. But, she was the final victim, shortest stay, rescued within 24 hours. Lucky her. Frank, where are we?
We are at Gary Heidnik's house.
And where's that address?
That address is 3520 Marshall Street.
North
Marshall Street.
So this is where it happened. This is where he took six of the victims and he tortured them. And he did a lot of other things. This house consisted of loud music, cannibalism, murder, electrocution, rape, beatings. It had money stapled all over the walls.
Cannibalism,
rare cars, money just flown out of the house, some stapled on the walls, like I mentioned. The weirdest of houses. And this could have been prevented. Several phone calls complaining of noise, foul odor, construction in the middle of the night, and nobody blinked an eye, and all this stuff happened. Decapitation, cutting off limbs, chopping off heads, boiling.
Mutilation.
A human head on a stove.
And that was a smell that everybody was smelling. Now, that's got to be pretty bad for your neighbors to be complaining.
Apparently, it boiled to the bone for weeks. You know, one of the girls that he was having trouble with, he brought her up to see the site, hopefully to, you know, calm her down. But, you know, to no avail. She also met her death there via water electrocution. So much stuff, so much, you know, I can't imagine it of what happened there.
A lot of evil going on in that house.
It started from November 25th, lasted to March 24th, a day before my birthday. So, from that time, so you figure November, December, January, February, end of March, that is a long time for some, and for nobody to see what was going on there is a pretty much a disgrace.
Probably felt like forever to them.
This incident could have been prevented so many times. He shouldn't even been on the streets. He should have been in prison 15, 20 years ago.
Yep.
But, so, we're going to insert some pictures. Here, 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 of all sick shit. And, because Frank, the editor, as he is, as I'm talking about this, you've probably seen some sick pictures already pop up on the screen.
Strong possibility.
Mm-hmm. And at the end of this, we're going to put up an Opie dick pic. Jared's going to have one right here. Yeah, so, I mean, this is crazy. So, we're going to get out. We're going to, I mean, the house is right there. So, we're going to get out.
Show you the house. It doesn't look like it did back then, obviously. What, 20, 30 years ago?
1986.
Yeah, so it doesn't look like what it does, but you can see the neighbor's house and a little bit like a little similar.
So when we show, so what did it look like back then, Frank?
What did it look like back then? Well, we can look for ourselves right there in that picture.
Man, if you could put that on there, that'd be pretty cool. But anyways, I want you to pay attention. So the side yard that you've seen, it's now a garage. Mm-hmm. The house, the top, they took off. It's now just two apartment buildings. The basement where all the stuff happened, it's just cemented straight through. Mm-hmm. And to the right, the other house is completely different. It's not more of a porch front. It's just a straight shot. They extended the porch to make it the house. Mm-hmm. But the house next to that, it is exactly the same. Same windows, same stirrups over
except
there.
Except it's yellow. It's yellow now.
Yeah, it's a new paint job, but the same like stirrups up top. Uh-huh. They're still there. The chimney in the back, I don't know if we're going to be able to see it or not because it's deeper.
That's still there.
But yeah, that's the house. That yep. is the actual...
And you just got to remember at the time, these girls were in the basement and it was just a dirt basement. Mm-hmm. You know, so there was holes dug that he kept them in and everything else. And probably seemed like hell to them.
I'm sure. So, we're going to show you the house. And yeah, so enjoy. Downfall of Mr. Gary Heidnik. Mm-hmm. So him and Miss Josefina Rivera, they go out as they usually do. Get some dinner, you know, get some, you know, they're out and about.
Get some cheeseburgers, McNuggets.
She convinces him. Hey, you know, let's, you know, I love you. We're gonna run away together. We're just gonna go. But just give me the opportunity to say goodbye to my family. You know, come to the gas station, get yourself
A nice cup of coffee. Hang out.
I'll be 20 minutes and we'll come back.
And we'll get out of there.
So mm-hmm. he lets her. Because he thinks, Frank, what's he think?
He thinks he's the shit.
He thinks you know? He has her under that much control that she can't make the decision for
yep.
herself.
It's sort of kind of like me and your mother, almost.
Mm. You know? My mom watches these.
She's a very lovely lady, mm-hmm. too.
So anyway, besides the point. So she gets out of the car, she starts walking down 6th Street. 6th and Oxford?
Takes an offer. That's correct.
That's where she finds the payphone, picks it up, mm-hmm. calls for help. Luckily, a patrol car is in the air. They meet her at 6th and Oxford. She She says, listen, if we don't go get him now, he's going to go back to this house and he's going to kill the rest of the girls.
Dead.
They believe him. So they come up on him at the gas station here. They, you know, they knock on the window.
He's just sitting there patiently.
He automatically thinks that they're there for his back child support. And the cop's response is, no, it's something a little more serious than that. Take him into custody. They make the left, which we'll be showing you, to the 26th Police mm-hmm. District, Philadelphia's finest.
Yep.
And he gets arrested. And this is the beginning of the downfall of Gary Heidnik. Soon after that, police cars go to the House of Horrors, and they uncover it.
Pretty much.
So, I guess we'll give you a shot here at the gas station. We couldn't find pictures of how it looked back then. But, I mean, probably a gas station, maybe a different name right now. It's a BP gas station. Who knows what it was back then. But
is that it?
That's it. Bad boys, what you want, what you want, what you gonna do? When the Chevy truck don't come for you? Tell me, what you wanna do, what you gonna do?
That about wraps it up for Mr. Heidnik. Went over a lot of information today. We've been a lot of places. So I hope you got a lot of information out of this. You know,
there's still some more information we need to convey.
There is. Please.
So, after everything was said and done, after the events of the 26th Police District, he goes there. He then transfers to City Hall, where he gets his trial. After he's taken from City Hall to the Roundhouse in Center City. After trial commences, he goes to upstate, well, I guess northwestern, Central PA. Stays in that facility, and that's where he's put to death. It takes up to from 87 convicted to 1999 for him to finally die. So that's where your taxpaying money is going. Was keeping him alive. I know you like this stuff. Do you know what his last meal was?
Spaghetti?
Close. Two slices of pizza, two cups of black coffee. And they allowed him to play country music outside of his jail cell.
Pizza and coffee?
Mm-hmm. So he was a hipster.
Pizza and coffee.
So, and then he died. He had one visitor. It was one of his many children. Just one person came. Didn't have any last words. That was it.
No, always a piece of shit.
And there goes Gary Heidnik.
But, what would your last meal be?
My last meal?
A dick?
Chicken parm.
Gotcha.
Chicken parm and like 10 pounders of Rolling Rock.
Get trashed before the...
No, absolutely.
Yeah. Well...
But yeah, hope you enjoyed the video. Like I said, a lot of it was more live. We were on the go today a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this is our third out and about.
Yeah.
Each out and about we do, we learn from our mistakes. One day we're gonna get Jer here. I know we do a lot of this on the weekday just to avoid the crowd, stuff like that.
And our schedules.
Oh yeah, our schedules conflict. But we have a big Halloween vlog coming up, which Jer will be a part of. We have our assigned movies we are going to watch.
And discuss.
Keep pumping in them questions. We already have a couple questions that we can answer. Mm-hmm. That's going to be pretty cool. Cool interactive.
Now, are these questions just through the movies?
Anything you want.
Anything.
Anything. Anything they want to ask.
Okay. Sounds good.
Any closing word, Frank?
No, I just had fun today, you know, driving around the city. You know, you've seen a lot of the city that you don't normally see. And, you know, it's always a good time.
Always.
How about you?
No, closing thoughts. Like I said, we got that Halloween vlog coming.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm going to do an unboxing, something I'm very excited. It's going to come to me. I'm going to probably show that. Frank probably is going to show off some of his stuff. Maybe Jared, I think he was talking about doing a pickup video. But just stay tuned. I know October is going to be a very busy month for us. Yes. Vacations, weddings, all types of stuff. So.
And I'm also trying to do my 31 Nights of Horror. I'll post everything on my Instagram, Rockers Reviews, every movie that I watch. I try to watch a little bit of mixture of movies that I haven't seen, foreign films, and, you know, the classics. So it's going to be a little difficult this year, but I'm going to, you know, try to bang it out.
Yep. And if you have any questions about the tour that we put you on today, where stuff's located, in the comment section.
Yep. Okay. Thanks for watching.
See you later.